In the latter part of the 18th century, a farmer went to the largest hotel in Baltimore, Maryland, requesting a room. He was a farmer, and he looked like he was a farmer. He was dressed like a farmer. And the manager decided maybe he wouldn't let him have a room. The man had money. He had plenty of money. He wasn't poor. He had one of the biggest farms in all Virginia. But the manager decided that this man, he really didn't set the right appearance that this man wanted in his hotel. And it might be bad advertisement to have a man like this, and so he sent him on his way. Well, the farmer, believing that all men were created equal and had an inalienable right to do what he wants, the man doesn't want to rent a room, he doesn't have to rent a room, so he went somewhere else and got a room. And later that manager just happened to find out that that man who came to him was actually the writer of the Declaration of Independence and the current Vice President of the United States. And so he sent back a message to Jefferson, asking him to return and to be his guest. And Jefferson sent a message back to him saying, "Tell him I have already engaged a room. I value his good intentions highly, but if he has no place for a dirty American farmer, he has none for the Vice President of the United States." And you know, I think today that sometimes we view Jesus Christ a little the same way. We have plenty of room for him in his gold divinity. We have plenty of room for him in his majesty and praise. But do we have room for the carpenter with the dirt under his nails and the splinters in his hands? Do we accept him in that way? Do we accept him in his humanity? And that's what we want to talk about today, is the humanity of Jesus. And I want to look, beginning at a couple of verses. We have looked at some in the last couple of weeks, but just as part of review and to add a little depth to them. And I want to begin in Matthew chapter 1. So turn our Bibles to Matthew chapter 1, beginning in verse 18. "Now the birth of Jesus Christ was on this wise. When as his mother Mary was espoused to Joseph, before they came together, she was found with child of the Holy Spirit. Then Joseph, her husband, being a just man, not willing to make her a public example, was minded to put her away privately. But while he thought on these things, behold, the angel of the Lord appeared unto him in a dream, saying, Joseph, thou son of David, fear not to take unto thee Mary thy wife, for that which is conceived in her is of the Holy Spirit. And she shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins." The angel makes an announcement to Joseph, and Joseph realizes that this is a miracle. This is something great. And this is understood by Matthew to be a fulfillment of a prophecy of Isaiah chapter 7 and verse 14. And going on, it says in verse 22, "Now all this was done that it might be fulfilled which was spoken of the Lord by the prophet, saying, Behold, a virgin shall be with child, and shall bring forth a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel, which being interpreted is God with us." Now let me ask you a question. Where in the book of Isaiah is that stated? Remember? Isaiah? It's not 9:6, that's something else, right? Not 8:20, that's something else. Isaiah 7:14. It says, "Behold, a virgin shall be a child, and I shall call his name Emmanuel." Meaning, interpreted, God with us. God with us. I'd like to invite you to go to the next slide if the other slide is available. Slide number 3. It's an interesting statement that A.T. Jones made. It was found in an early American Sentinel and a few other places, but might most commonly be found in the book, The Consecrated Way of Christian Perfection. And there Jones says, "Not God with him only, but God with us. God was with him in eternity and could have been with him even though he had not given himself for us. But man, through sin, became without God. And God wanted to be again with us. Therefore, Jesus became us, that God with him might be God with us." And obviously, if you didn't know A.T. Jones wrote that, once I read it, you probably would know if you read much of A.T. Jones. Typical Jones style. But it's so true and so pertinent. In Luke chapter 1 and verse 35, we could turn to Luke chapter 1, verse 35. Luke 1:35, "And the angel answered and said unto her, the Holy Ghost or the Holy Spirit shall come upon thee, and the power of the highest shall overshadow thee. Therefore also that holy thing which shall be born in thee shall be called the Son of God. Now in your King James, if you're using a King James Bible, you know that most any time you have a word that has been added by the translators in the hope of making the verse more clear as we translate from one language to another, that those words in the King James Version are what? Italicized. They're in italics type of color. It's sort of slanted or squiggly type. But there's a word in this verse that has been added by the translators that's not in the original text. And it is probably in the second or second to last line, maybe from the end of the verse in your Bible, where it says, also that holy thing. The word thing is a supplied word in this text and is not part of the original text. Now, the reason that something has been supplied is because the word holy is a word that in the Greek is in an adjective form. And I'm going to proceed to the next slide. It tells us that the word holy is hagion from the Greek word hagios. But the point I want to make is that this word is in an adjective form. We have here a interlinear with transliteration and voice, mood, verb, tense listings. And if you notice down in the bottom, under thing, there's no word there. You just have this word hagion above it. And you see there it's spelling in the Greek. But you see below that, you see a J-N-S-N, if you can see the slide. It says J-N-S-N. But those are abbreviations for certain things. And one thing it's telling us is that this is an adjective. It's in an adjective form. So it has to modify something. But in the Greek, gender is very important. Gender is very important. Now, in English, we don't use gender in our words a lot. We have a ship, and we think the ship is a she, even if it has a man's name. It's a she. You know, you might have the aircraft carrier Ronald Reagan, but it's still a she, the aircraft carrier itself. But in Greek language, most everything has either a masculine or a feminine connotation to it, and it requires a masculine or a feminine pronoun or noun to go with it. Sometimes it's neuter. It's neither masculine nor feminine. There are several neuter words. And holy is one of them. And in Greek, it's very specific. If it's a masculine adjective, it has to have a masculine noun to modify. It always works that way. There are no exceptions, except for poor grammar students in Greek. You know, I can just imagine those early Greek teachers and how they're saying, no, that's the wrong one. It's masculine, not feminine, or whatever. We can imagine teaching such things today, can't you? And that should be a plus sign, not a negative sign. But this is a neuter word. And therefore, it has to have something that is neuter to modify it. Now, if you look at this chart, and the last letter is the one that tells its gender. And start looking for words that have an N, a noun that have an N at the end of them here, that it could possibly modify. And you know, there's interesting, there's only one word in the whole verse that qualifies. Do you see what that word is? The only noun in here that happens to also be singular and happens to also be neuter is right here, ghost. It's number 4151 in the Strong's numbers, if you're interested. It's pneuma. And it's also linked here with what word? Hagion, which is the same word that's used down here for holy. Holy, holy, same word. Hagion, in adjective form. And therefore, the King James translators, because they don't understand the truth of God much, they're trying to think, well, what are we going to translate this? What are we going to supply here? And they put in the word thing. But if we're looking at the strict context of the verse, the most reasonable thing to put in based upon the Greek is the word pneuma, or spirit. That Holy Spirit which shall be born of thee.
That's right.
That's what the text says. And interestingly, our advanced pioneers, they understood that if there was a Trinity, Jesus would really not be the Son of the Father. He'd be the Son of the Holy Spirit.
Right.
And they couldn't accept that kind of an idea. Now, let's go to John chapter 1, verse 1. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word, what?
Was
God. Now, who is this Word? Jesus Christ. And in verse 14, it says that this Word was made what?
Flesh.
Was made flesh and dwelt among us. Now, it's interesting that the Greek word for made is not created, it's to be brought forth, or to be even born, as it were, sometimes. But I want you to notice a couple things about these verses. First of all, in verse 1, the Word was God. You have a root here, root word, ami. And it's the word in Greek that means to exist or to be, to am. I am. Jesus said, ego ami. And we'll look at that later. It means I am. But we're translating this as a past tense because this is in what is called the imperfect form. And it simply becomes what we call am, and it's pronounced am. It looks like an en in the transliteration, but that's the imperfect form of a me. And that's what's used here in John chapter 1, verse 1. In the beginning was the Word. And the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And all those are in the imperfect sense. In fact, if we go to the next slide, we see here, if you look here on the chart, you have was, and it's the same in or the imperfect form of a me in each time. And it's imperfect. And what does that mean? Well, the imperfect form denotes continual action. Continual action. I might say that I hit the bat, or I hit something, and if I just hit it one time and I stop, in the past tense in the Greek, that's what's called the aorist tense. It has a definite point. But if I hit and I keep hitting and I keep hitting, that's the imperfect. And what this implies is continuous action, because it's pushing to the past, it's denoting continuous action of the past. In other words, from all eternity, the Lord Jesus Christ was one with the Father. We're told that. His goings forth have been from old, from everlasting. Whatever eternity is, that Word was with the Father in that point. And He was with the Father. He was God Himself. He was divine. He was the Son of God. We have here a statement from Ellen G. White, and she says here that He united humanity with divinity. A divine spirit dwelt in a temple of flesh. And I want you to notice the punctuation. Because in this sentence, the first punctuation mark you come to is what? A colon. And the colon indicates that the second clause becomes a definition for the first. And so the uniting of humanity and divinity is a divine spirit dwelling in a temple of flesh. But remember in Luke 1:35, it says, that holy thing, that Holy Spirit, which shall be born of thee, that Holy Spirit, she says, a divine spirit, dwelt in a temple of flesh. And that was the uniting of humanity and divinity. The one then who had existed from all that we know of as far as eternity is, as one with the Father, now at a specific point in time, becomes one with man, flesh. See, Jesus hadn't always existed as a man, as flesh. But from whatever back in eternity there is, as long as there had been eternity, as long as the Son had existed, to use the common phrase of man, He was with God. But now He becomes with man. In our next slide, we have a statement from the youth instructor of July 20, 1899. I just want to pause and make a note here that the last statement we had was also from the youth instructor of 1900. This is from the youth instructor of 1899, just about 6 months or so apart in July. And Ellen White didn't think that the issue of the Incarnation was too hard to study or too difficult for young people to grasp. She put these things in the youth instructor. That's what they're there for. And sometimes we as adults, we grapple with some of these concepts ourselves. But she wanted everybody to understand this. And our young people, our old people, we all need to understand some of these basic fundamental points of the Incarnation. We shouldn't be confused on them. But here's what she says. The work of redemption is called a mystery. Do you remember any places in the Bible? We talked about that a few weeks ago, where the Bible speaks about the Incarnation as a mystery. Where at? Well, how about Colossians 1:27, 1 Timothy 3:16, and some others? It's the mystery. Great is the mystery of godliness. God manifested power in the flesh. She says the work of redemption is called a mystery. And that Greek word for mystery is what? Mysterion. And it means a deep secret which God wills to be revealed. She says the work of redemption is called a mystery. And it is indeed the mystery by which everlasting righteousness is brought to all who believe. In consequence of sin, the race was at enmity with God at an infinite cost, and by a process mysterious to angels as well as to men, Christ assumed humanity, hiding his divinity, laying aside his glory. He was born a babe in Bethlehem. It says that even the angels don't understand this process. It's mysterious to even the angels. Well, how can I understand? I can't, friends. I can't understand the how, but I can understand the why. I can understand the purpose that God has in the Incarnation. But how did this happen, other than the simple statements of the Bible that the Holy Spirit came upon this virgin woman, Mary? We don't know. It's mysterious even to the angels, someone might say. Now, we need to understand that when we read the Bible has, I guess we could say, many purposes. There's many facets to the reasons that we have the Scriptures as they are. But I'd like to say two main reasons. Number one is first to give us the facts. We read a news report and we want to know what happened. What is the message? But then we need to be able to interpret those facts. Now today, if you read the news, there's all kinds of people who are commentators. And it's their job to spin the news, as they say. You know, to put a spin on it, put a slant on it, to make people interpret the news in the way that they want interpreted. But you know, friends, God has been in that business for a long time, but his difference is that his spin is always truth. His spin is never wrong. His spin is never slanted. But God wants us to understand what the Scriptures say, and he wants us to understand what they're saying to us and how to rightly interpret them. Go to Luke chapter 24, and we'll see an example. In Luke chapter 24, we have the story of Jesus when he was on the road to Emmaus with two disciples. And he had been expounding to these people. They took him into the house and they were going to eat. In verse 44, and he said unto them, these are the words which I spake unto you while I was yet with you. All things must be fulfilled which were written in the law of Moses and in the prophets and in the Psalms concerning me. Then opened he their understanding that they might understand the Scriptures. See, they had a superficial knowledge of these prophecies, of these statements. But they couldn't put it together. And I think that there's much of that today. We have a superficial knowledge, maybe even a deep knowledge of the texts themselves. But just quoting the text, you know, sometimes I quiz you, you know, where's this text, where's that text? And that's good, that has its place, but until we know what the text means too, we haven't been really helped. We need to have an understanding of what these mean. Now, as we see Jesus today, we clearly see the Son of God. But his person, as seen after the Incarnation and before the resurrection, was not understood by those without the aid of the Holy Spirit. In other words, as you look through the Gospel accounts, you'll find that Jesus was, to most people's minds and eyes, just simply another man, just simply another teacher. Turn with me to Matthew chapter 16. Here we have the great confession of Peter. Matthew chapter 16. Starting in verse 13. When Jesus came into the coast of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, saying, whom do men say I, the Son of Man, am? And they said, some say that thou art John the Baptist, some Elias, or others, Jeremiah, or one of the prophets. And he said to them, but whom say ye that I am? You see how the people, they saw Jesus as a prophet, but really not much more than a prophet. In other words, they saw him as a man. Just simply a man. And he asked him, who do you say I am? Peter said, thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. And notice the answer of Jesus to that. Verse 17. Jesus answered and said unto him, blessed art thou, Simon Barjona, for flesh and blood hath not revealed it unto thee, but my Father which is in heaven. The only way that we can understand the identity and the person of Jesus Christ, whether it's his divinity or his humanity, and to put this together is through the divine illumination of the Spirit of God. Jesus said that flesh and blood have not revealed this to you. In other words, the faculties of human perception of themselves could not see that this was the Son of the living God before him. Only a mind enlightened by the Spirit of God would understand. In Mark chapter 5, in verse 35 through 40, we have a story. We'll read part of it here. Jesus had been called to the house of Jairus because his daughter was ill. While he yet spake, there came from the ruler of the synagogue's house certain which said, Thy daughter is dead. Why troublest thou the master any further? As soon as Jesus heard the word that was spoken, he saith unto the ruler of the synagogue, Be not afraid, only believe. And he suffered no man to follow him, save Peter and James and John, the brother of James. And he came to the house of the ruler of the synagogue, and seeth the tumult, and them that wept and wailed greatly. Verse 39. And when he was coming, he saith unto them, Why make ye this ado and weep? The damsel is not dead, but sleepeth. And they laughed him to scorn. Can you imagine this? Here he is, the King of Glory. Do you think these people, if they had realized that Jesus was the Son of God, the Creator of this earth, the giver of life, do you think they would have laughed him to scorn if they could have seen him in his majesty and beauty? Oh no, they would have trembled with fear, friends. They would not have dared to have scorned him. But how did they see him? They perceived him as just a man, and Christ said, we should just sleep him. In Romans chapter 1, in verse 3, concerning his son Jesus Christ our Lord, which was made of the seed of David according to the flesh. Yes, they could see him as the seed of David. That's okay. But not the Son of God. The Son of God doesn't come down to this world and live with human beings. But friends, we need to understand that Jesus shared the common experiences of humanity that most would not have expected a God to share. And they see him experiencing these things. And they say, wait, God doesn't get tired. I mean, didn't Jesus get tired? In Mark chapter 4, verse 35. And the same day when the eve was come, he said unto them, Let us pass over unto the other side. And when they had sent away the multitude, they took him even as in the ship. And there were also with them other little ships. And there arose a great storm of wind, and the waves beat into the ship, so that it was now full. He was in the hinder part of the ship. What was he doing? He's asleep. And he's had on a pillow. Why? He was exhausted from the day's work, friends. He got tired. Now let's go to John. John chapter 4. And you know the story of Jesus at the well, Jacob's well, with the Samaritan woman? John chapter 4. But did you notice some of the words that were used here? Verse 6. Now Jacob's well was there, Jesus therefore being wearied. He was wearied with his journey. What does that mean if you're weary?
I'm tired.
You're tired. You're tuckered out. You're ready for a break. That wasn't all he was. Verse 7 tells us he was also thirsty. Jesus got tired. He got thirsty. And Jesus could weep. What's that shortest verse in the Bible? And that's found in John 11:35. Jesus wept. And I know that he wept because of seeing down the road and the destruction that was coming. But he also wept because, as it says in our next slide of the Zohar of Ages, page 533, though he was the Son of God, yet he had taken human nature upon him, and he was moved by human sorrow. His tender, pitying heart is ever awakened to sympathy by suffering. He weeps with those who weep and rejoices with those that rejoice. Because of his human sympathy with Martha and Mary, Jesus wept. And so he had these emotions. And that's why he was there in verse 33. It says that he groaned. He groaned in his spirit. In Matthew chapter 26, in the Garden of Gethsemane, he said, My soul is exceedingly sorrowful, even unto death. And so as the people saw Jesus, he was to them, as it were, very human. And this is expressed in the way that they saw him. And even John the Baptist, in a sense, at least partially. But while we're in John, let's go to John 20 first. And we're going to come back and look at some verses here and some points. John chapter 20. Does John tell us why he wrote his gospel? You know he does, obviously. I wouldn't ask that question, right? He tells us a specific reason why he wrote his gospel. What is that specific reason? What's in John chapter 20, verses 30 and 31. And there it says, And many other signs truly did Jesus in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written, that that ye might believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that believing ye might have life through His name. John says, the reason I wrote this gospel is that you could believe Jesus is the Son of God. And so we would think that if we go through the Gospel of John, we're going to see a lot of emphasis that Jesus is the Son of God. And we do. But I think it's what's interesting is, not only in the Gospel of John, but in the whole Bible, the way that we see Christ portraying Himself through His own words and through the inspired writers. If we would go to our next slide, we see a little chart here. And this speaks about the expression Son of God and Son of Man. There's two different columns here. You have Son of God on the left, Son of Man on the right. There's the numbers beside the books of the Bible represent the number of times that expression is used in the book. Not a chapter or a verse, mind you. For instance, in the book of Daniel, the term Son of God, Jesus is referred to as the Son of God one time in the book of Daniel, Daniel chapter 3. But in Matthew chapter 8, He's mentioned 8 times as the Son of God. In Mark, 3 times. In Luke, 6 times. In the book of John, 10 times. Paul's epistles, 10 times. In John's epistle, 6 times, and once in the Revelation, a total of 7. But a total of 47 usages. But on the Son of Man, notice the usages now. Once in the book of Daniel. And by the way, on the Son of God's, I should tell you that some of those references are not directly positively teaching Jesus as the Son of God, but where people were questioning if He was the Son of God. Even. So they weren't all positive declarations that He was the Son of God. But when you come over to the second chart where it talks about Him being the Son of Man, I believe all those are positive declarations, either an affirmation of Jesus Himself saying He's the Son of Man or of someone else. But Daniel, He's referred to as the Son of Man in one place. Matthew, 31 times. Matthew, the Gospel of Matthew, you know, the Gospel that sets Him forth as the Lion of the tribe of Judah, as this kingly feature, kingly man, says He's the Son of Man 31 times. Mark, 14 times. Luke, 25 times. John, 12 times. Acts and Revelation each have one reference, total of 86 times. The point I'm making from this, I think it's very visible, is that though Jesus Christ is clearly the Son of God, He is portrayed almost twice as often as the Son of Man as the Son of God. And in fact, His favorite expression, or at least the one that He Himself used the most to refer to Himself, was the Son of Man. He wanted us to understand that He identified with humanity. And this was picked up upon by other people. In John chapter 1, verse 30, we have some statements. Let me draw from John now. John chapter 1, verse 30. John the Baptist, referring to Jesus, notice how he describes Him. This is He of whom I said, after me cometh a man which is preferred before me, for he was before me. But notice the words. He says, after me cometh a man. Comes a man. Notice the people's perception in John chapter 7, in verse 27. They said, how that we know this man whence he is. But when Christ cometh, no man knoweth whence he is. But he said, we know where this man comes from. Who is he? He's a man. That's the way they perceive him. In John chapter 8 and verse 40, he says, but now ye seek to kill me, a man that hath told you the truth. And of course, the famous statement of Pilate, when he's standing before the people, he says, behold, the man, John 19:5. Now, Jesus claimed to be the man. He claimed to be something more than just simply a man. In fact, if we go to John chapter 6, we have a story here, continuing of where Jesus was walking on water, coming to meet the disciples. And remember, at first the Bible says that they were frightened. They thought that they were seeing an apparition or something. And in verse 20, but He, that is Jesus, saith unto them, it is I, be not afraid. It is I, be not afraid. It's interesting, if we go to our next slide, the expression there is ego ami. It's ego ami. And that is the Greek which simply says, I am. It says, it is me. It says, I am. But Jesus had said this before. Jesus had said this before. John chapter 8 and verse 24. I said therefore unto you that ye shall die in your sins. For if ye believe not that I am, you shall die in your sins. Now, you notice I read that a little different than the text says, didn't I? What did I read different? I left out the italicized word. Sometimes you need an italicized word, and sometimes the translators put something in thinking to make it more clear, but it's simply this expression in the Greek, ego me. And it says, before Abraham was, I am, in John 8, 58. Here he says, unless you believe that I am, you shall die in your sins. Now, who was that I am? What is he making a reference back to? To the book of Exodus, in the burning bush, and the I am that I am. And Jesus is saying, I am that individual. And he said, and if we go to the next slide, in John 6:35, he says, I am the bread of life. He says, I am the living bread from heaven, John 6:51. He says, I am the light of the world, John 8:12. In John chapter 10, verse 9, I am the door. John 11:25, I am the resurrection and the life. And in John 14:6, I am the way, the truth, and the life. He says, no man cometh unto the Father but by me. The people understood what he was saying, because they took up stones. They were going to kill him for saying these things, because they realized he was claiming to be someone other than just a man. A man, yes, but someone more than just a man. Someone who would live a life such as we have the privilege to live. Someone who would show us the way. I like the little science demonstration that we were doing in Sabbath school earlier today. They were working with pieces of paper and twisting them and taping them together, making what are called Mobius bands, Mobius strips. But I like it because I could watch it, and we'll have the video online for those who didn't see it. I literally couldn't see it, but I watched the demonstration, and if I just heard that if you do this with paper, you cut it in certain ways, perform certain actions, you're going to get certain results. And one of those results, if you had told me before, I would have said, no way, never happened, you can't make that. But I saw it happen. Now I know, in our Christian experience, we don't go by seeing. Seeing is not believing. Believing is seeing. But it is nice to see a demonstration of something, isn't it? But I tell you, friends, we need to know that there is a demonstration that's been made that Christians can live a holy life. That we have that ability. And Jesus presented before us the way that that works. In John chapter 5, in verse 16, therefore did the Jews persecute Jesus and sought to slay him because he had done these things on the Sabbath day. Verse 17. But Jesus answered them, my Father worketh here too, and I work. Therefore the Jews sought the more to kill him, because he not only had broken the Sabbath, but said also that God was his Father, making himself equal with God. Then answered Jesus and said unto them, verily, verily, I say unto you, the Son can do nothing of himself, but what he seeth the Father do, for what things soever he doeth, these also doeth the Son likewise. You see here, he says that he's working and his Father works. And the Jews understood well the implications of this, because it says in verse 18, they're going to stone him for this. But Jesus replied, look, but I can do nothing but myself. Jesus, in other words, was stating that I have an absolute, total, and complete dependence upon my Father. I can do nothing except I do it with my Father. Now, in the book Desire of Ages, on page 336, speaking about that time when Jesus was on the boat, resting, remember, he has been on the ground, sleeping, it says, when Jesus was awakened to meet the storm, he was in perfect peace. There was no trace of fear in word or look, for no fear was in his heart. But he rested not in the possession of almighty power. It was not as the master of earth and sea and sky that he reposed in quiet. That power he had laid down, he says, I can of my own self do nothing, John 5:30. He trusted in the Father's might. It was in faith, faith in God's love and care, that Jesus rested, and the power of that word which stilled the storm was the power of God. Concerning the transfiguration, in our next slide, Ellen White says, that he prays for strength to endure the test in behalf of humanity. He must himself gain a fresh hold on omnipotence. Desire of Ages, page 420. Now, I want to ask you a question. If I possess something innately, do I have to obtain a fresh new hold on it every time I want to use it? Have access to it? I think we can see not. We can understand that in the Incarnation, in some very real way, that when we speak about Jesus laying aside his glory, clothing his divinity with humanity, that while he never gave up his divine person, his divine identity, his pure Holy Spirit, that in the Incarnation there were certain limitations that he accepted. One was omniscience. He grew in wisdom and stature and favor with God and man. And you can't grow on something if you already have it. But he didn't have all wisdom in the universe. He said, that day and hour no man knoweth, not even the Son or the angels. Matthew 24:36. We know, based upon any portion of the Gospels you want, and you can just think of John 11 as an example, that Jesus surely wasn't omnipresent. He didn't hold Lazarus' hand when he died. And he says in John 5:30, as we read there, and also John 5:19 that we read, he says, I can of my own self do nothing. But all the power and all the work was done through the power of God. He depended upon the Father for everything. In John chapter 14, verse 10, he says, Believest thou not that I am in the Father, and the Father in me? The words that I speak unto you, I speak not of myself, but the Father that dwelt in me, he doeth the works. That's what Jesus said. And if you go to the Desire of Ages again on page 143, it says, The miracles of Christ for the afflicted and suffering were wrought by the power of God. Amen? And that's what Jesus said. But she adds a little line to this. She says, through the ministration of the angels. So the power of God was wrought through the angels. And that was the power of God through the angels. As Jesus would heal people, he was healing them based upon authority, not on power innately, not on dunamis, but rather on exousia, on authority in that sense. In continuing the Desire of Ages, on our next slide, on page 536, it says, They accused him of performing miracles by the power of Satan, but here Christ claims God as his Father with perfect confidence, declares that he is the Son of God. In all that he did, Christ was cooperating with his Father. Ever had he been careful to make it evident that he did not work independently. It was by faith and prayer that he wrought his miracles. Now, I want to ask you, friends, is the ministry of angels open to us today?
Yes.
Is the power of God available to us today? Do we have the ability to have faith and to pray today? I think we do. He exercised in his behalf no power that is not offered freely to us. Let me just stop there. You mean he used power that I don't have innately? Yes. I don't have a lot of power, I don't have those skills, I don't have those miracles, I don't have those wisdoms and abilities. But I can have them. Because I can have faith, I can have prayer. Jesus will work with me, God will work with me, Christ will work with me. And so whatever he had is available to us, is the plain one. That's what it's saying here. Let me go back and read it from the beginning. He exercised in his behalf no power that is not freely offered to us. As a man, he met temptation and overcame in the strength given him from God. He says, I delight to do thy will, O my God. Yea, thy law is within my heart. Psalms 40, verse 8. As he went about doing good and healing all who were afflicted by Satan, he made plain to men the character of God's law and the nature of his service. His life testifies that it is possible for us also to obey the law of God. In Signs of the Times, June 17, 1894, it says, why? Very human nature. He was dependent upon the omnipotence for his life. In his humanity, he laid hold of the divinity of God, and this every member of the human family has the privilege of doing. Christ did nothing that human nature may not do if it partakes of the divine nature. Signs of the Times, June 17, 1897. That's the secret. You know, the Apostle Peter, 2 Peter 1:4, says that we are to be partakers of the divine nature. We are to receive the Spirit of Christ into our lives. The Word was made flesh and dwelt among us. And it's true, he was the seed of the woman. He was the son of David. He was the root of Jesse. He is a near kinsman. And he was even one like unto the brazen serpent. And you know, the Jewish nation, they were looking for a Messiah. And yet, if we turn to John chapter 1 and verse 11, we find the testimony of their reaction to Jesus. Pretty simple. John chapter 1, verse 11. He came into his own, and his own received him not. He came to them, and he came to them on their level, in their way, and they received him not. Why? Because, beloved, they were looking for one who would reveal himself through omnipotence, through omniscience, and through omnipresence. They were not looking for, not wanting a Redeemer who would meet the demands of the law on a level that could be lived on, that they could live on. Such an example, friends, would place too much of a demand upon their lives and the development of their character. And could it be that such is also the problem with us today concerning the doctrine of the Incarnation? And whenever we hear the doctrine of the Incarnation taken and twisted and distorted and preached to make Jesus someone altogether not like us, who could not understand our temptations, who could not be tempted like we're tempted, it's because the demands of the perfection of the law and the demands of the character it would require to believe otherwise are not powerful. Jesus came into his own. His own received him not. He came to the people that bear the three angels' messages. And it's sad to say that many received him not. But that's not the question for you today. The question for you today is, will you receive him? He's come to each one of us. Today, will you receive him?